This time around, we're going to be taking a look at how to make this rotating cube, as well as learning a little bit about the math that makes it work. Mostly, this video is just a vehicle to introduce linear algebra, which isn't an oscilloscope-specific idea, but more generally useful for many things, including computer graphics. Now, I'm no mathematician, but as we're about to see, that doesn't mean we can't start gaining a little knowledge and put these ideas to good use. Let's dive right in, see how to make this thing, and learn a little math along the way. I'm going to start with something that y'all should be familiar with by now, which is using an array and linear interpolation as a method for drawing things on the scope. If that sounds like gobbledygook to you, you'll want to check out the previous video I've made on the subject. Since our goal is to draw this cube, I'm going to first create my arrays to hold all the points. Remember that the order of the points is very important. If we just throw the data into the arrays willy-nilly, all the lines connecting the points of the cube will be in the incorrect places. For now, trust me that this is the correct one. Explaining how we get this order is a little involved and a topic for another video. The other thing that I'm only going to touch on briefly here is how I got these points in the first place. For a cube, it's actually not too bad to just think about how they lie in 3D space and work it out in your head. Not so bad for this particular shape, but rather unwieldy for more complex models. One hacky way to do this is to open up an oscistudio file in a text editor and look at the vertices. This also gets unwieldy if you've got lots of points to deal with. You'll notice that in PD, I used 16 points instead of the 8 listed here. That's because, while oscistudio is using the same technique we're putting together in PD, it goes about it in a slightly different way. In our method, I've got duplicates of the points because in order to connect all the points and draw the cube, we'll have to visit each point twice. Digression aside, we've got the array part of this method taken care of, so now we can add the linear interpolation part and we'll see that we're finally drawing something. It looks like I've made a mistake, but what's really happening is that we're viewing the cube perfectly from one of its sides. If I use this rotation object that we'll be building in a moment, we can see that we were successful in drawing the cube. Well, this is sort of interesting, but how does this rotation object work? For that, we'll need to learn a little bit about linear algebra. In a certain sense, we've already been making use of it. All the way back at the start of this series, when we learned about drawing circles and some methods for manipulating them, one way to think about those transformations is through the mathematical lens of linear algebra. Linear algebra is by no means a simple subject, but for the purposes of getting started, we only really need to understand a few things. First, a basic idea of what a vector is, and second, what a matrix is. Much of linear algebra revolves around working with vectors and matrices, and our situation is no different. So, what is a vector? From our oscilloscope music and art perspective, it's basically just a point in space. If we're in 2D, our vector has two numbers, one for x and y. If we're in 3D, we'll have three numbers, one for x, y, and z. For oscilloscope music, we use them to tell our computer, hey, I'd like for you to move the beam over here. If we generate enough of these vectors in a specific way, we can start drawing things. Okay, that's cool, I guess. But what about matrices? What are those, and how are they going to be useful? A matrix describes a transformation that we can perform on a vector. It takes a vector as input, transforms it in some way, and then outputs our new, modified vector. For us, that means we can use a matrix to do things like translation, scaling, rotating, and a heck of a lot more. I won't be going over the details of how to actually perform these calculations, but in order to build the rotation bit in PD, we'll need to know how to transform a vector with a matrix, so here's a quick animation that shows what's going on. In practice, we won't ever really be calculating these things by hand anyways. This is a task that is best suited for computers. If you're interested in getting better at making computer graphics or making art on oscilloscopes, I highly recommend getting at least somewhat proficient with linear algebra. A little bit of knowledge goes a long way. It's a very ubiquitous mathematical tool. I'm skipping over a lot to keep the video succinct, and there's already lots of great resources on linear algebra. I've provided some links in the description to get you started. I said that we've technically already been using linear algebra, but what did I really mean by that? Well, if we look at the circle example from earlier in the series, we can see that we had to calculate its x and y position using these parametric equations. Since a vector can be thought of as a point in space, we can see this step right here as calculating its position vector. Then we can perform some transformations on that vector, scale it by multiplying it, applying an offset, and so on. Anyhow, that was a very small dip of the toes into some mathematical waters, but let's get back to making that rotating cube. We know that the output from the linear interpolation is just a bunch of vectors, all the positions that will draw our cube. And we also know that a matrix can transform a vector. So let's use a rotation matrix. We can look this up on Wikipedia and consequently get bombarded by every fact you'd ever want to know about them. But as always, we don't want to read this whole thing. We're just looking for the matrix. This first one is cool. It shows us how to do it in 2D, but we're looking for 3D. We keep scrolling, and these look more like what we want. Right here, this massive one is the matrix we'll be implementing in PD. Incidentally, this will also show us why sometimes lines of code is simply the better choice. Okay, this looks scary, but it's not so bad. I promise. We'll start by making a subpatch to handle the rotation for us. Next, we'll pre-compute the sine and cosine of all our angles. This will save some time later, and as a bonus, it helps to keep the patch clean. Next, we'll use this snake tilde object. This is a newer object in more recent versions of PD, but I'm using it strictly for cosmetic purposes, so it's by no means required. Now, in the subpatch, we'll make another set of subpatches, one to calculate the new x, y, and z components for the vector we're transforming. Basically, this is where we do the vector matrix multiplication. Inside each of these subpatches, we can conveniently use snake tilde to get our components back, and then apply the transformation. I'm going to skip over the expansion of the matrix transformation. These three equations on screen are what you should arrive at, but if you want some practice, see if you can work it out on your own. One little PD trick to note here is that I've chosen the $V symbols to match up with snake tilde so that the patch cables look cleaner. After running through expert tilde, we have our transformed vector. We'll connect up everything to the proper outlets, and now let's test it out. The first three inputs is our vector that we want to transform, and then our next three are the angles of rotation around the x, y, or z axis we might want to apply. You'll notice that just like before, the cube is too large, so I'll scale it down a little so that we can see the whole thing. If we set our angles to these numbers and use a phaser to generate a continuous rotation around the y axis here, we'll arrive at the image we had at the start of the video. Pretty cool. There's a couple things to note here. First off, from one perspective, we're simply rotating the cube. From a different perspective, though, this is a cheap way to project the cube from three dimensions down into two dimensions. There's all sorts of different ways to project from one dimension down into another. That's how people are able to make those videos of four-dimensional and above objects, but with a little rotation, you can also achieve this effect. The other thing to note here is that order matters when transforming vectors with matrices. So, say I had a subpatch that applied a translation to the cube. If I translate, then rotate, that doesn't look the same as if I had rotated, then translated. Alright, PD was cool and all, but as always, when it comes to dealing with 3D geometries, the Blender oscistudio connection is the way to go. We'll start with using a default shape, and first off, oscistudio already has a rotation effect built in, so we could just use that. Easy peasy. But it'd be cooler if we had a little more control and wrote some code. That way, we can have it work in any way that we want it to, not just the way it was given to us. I'll start by creating a new livecoding plugin. By default, we start out with some code that simply grabs the current thing we're drawing and passes it on without changing it. All we need to do is call the vector's rotate method and choose our x, y, and z rotation. Having a number hard-coded in is a bit boring, so let's add some sliders so we can change these numbers around to whatever we want. We could also use a phaser instead, like we did in PD, and have the angle change over time automatically. This is loads of fun to mess around with. oscistudio has most of the standard linear algebra functions you'd want in a library like this. You can learn more about them in the documentation by clicking the little question mark at the top. In the GitHub tutorial for this series, I'll also be including a version where we don't use the built-in cube oscistudio has and build the whole thing by hand. It's very similar to how we did it in PD, but some things change because of how we write code in C++. One of my favorite things to do when working on new material is to just mess around with the parameters and see what happens. I like to do my best to try and not make any assumptions about what is going to be interesting and just have fun messing around. If I discover something that I think is especially cool, I'll start iterating on it, as well as making a note about what the settings I used to make it are. oscistudio doesn't have a preset system really, so you'll have to be very studious about jotting down your settings if you find something you really like. Anywho, that's all I've got for you today, so until next time, I hope that this was helpful and that you took a thing or two away.